Dear doctor colleagues and student friends, today we will be discussing about vertigo. Vertigo or vertigo is a rotational sensation of either self or the environment, and sometimes the sensation takes the form of up and down movement, the way you go ascend in a lift, and this results in severe disability of the patient. The patient cannot walk without support, and at times it also leads to vomiting. So why does vertigo occur? Typically, vertigo results from disorder of the vestibular function, and of course, since the vestibular connections are with the brainstem, therefore even in the disorders of brainstem also you can have vertigo. But there is a difference which we will come to very soon. Whenever a patient of vertigo comes, you have to make sure, number one, that it is not something dangerous like a transient ischemic attack or a stroke or a cardiac arrhythmia, which all can lead to acute sudden vertigo, and whether the lesion is vestibular and it is peripheral. I will be soon describing a few clinical tests which will guide you to make a diagnosis. It should also be differentiated from pre-syncopal dizziness. We have learnt about syncope. Syncope is sudden fall of a standing person, and therefore pre-syncopal dizziness is also found only in standing person. It cannot be found in a person who is lying down on a bed. But vertigo can be found in any position. One is standing, one is sitting on a chair, or one is lying down on the bed, still one can have vertigo. That is the sensation of rotation of self or the environment. Vertigo implies asymmetry of dysfunction of the two vestibules. In symmetrical equal dysfunction of the two vestibules, there is no vertigo, although there can be imbalance in standing, sitting, or any other position. In history, if you also find symptoms like diplopia, numbness, or limb ataxia, then it is suggestive of more central lesion rather than the peripheral vestibular lesion. Now coming to examination, I want to introduce a couple of terms. Number one, the term saccades. Saccades is a jerky movement of the eyeball, which is also known as the corrective movement. If you focus on an object and tilt your head 20 degree this side and 20 degree that side, the focus remains stable and your eyes don't appear to be doing any jerky movements. But this is all done by the vestibulo-ocular reflex, and if that reflex goes disordered, then you can have jerky movements of the eyes. In order to test this, the patient is made to sit on a chair and to focus on a pinpoint object, and then the observer rotates the head towards one side by about 20 degree, and if another observer observes saccades or jerky movements in the eyes, then there is a diagnosis of vestibular dysfunction. The test should be repeated on the other side, and on the disorder side the saccades will be found. Another term that I want to introduce is nystagmus. Nystagmus is a continuous jerky movement of the eyeballs. It could be either in a horizontal or in a vertical or a rotational plane. And to elicit nystagmus, again, several tests have been described. We will describe one or two tests over here. There is one Dix-Hallpike maneuver in which the patient is made to sit on a couch, and there should be space enough to make him lie down and let the head hang backwards. So the patient is made to sit at first, and the head is tilted towards one side by 45 degrees, and then the observer makes the patient lie down flat with the neck and head hyperextended and hanging at the edge of the couch. And at that time, if nystagmus appears, the nystagmus could be vertical with a torsional element, and if this is observed, then the diagnosis of BPPV, benign paroxysmal positional vertigo can be made with great confidence. In this test, Frenzel's glasses or Frenzel's goggles also can be used, and that will increase the sensitivity of the test because these glasses enlarge the eyeballs and you can see a much bigger image of the two eyes, and therefore the sensitivity of the test improves. The most common cause of vertigo is acute prolonged vertigo. Earlier we used to call it viral labyrinthitis, but since all these years no virus could be isolated and no antiviral drug could prove to be effective, therefore the name has been changed and it is now known as acute prolonged vertigo. The patient typically wakes up in the morning and finds that he can't even change posture in the bed and he cannot stand up or walk. So he requires support to go to the bathroom even, and this is a self-limiting illness. It will last for about 3 to 4 days and then there is a spontaneous remission. Usually we employ the vestibular suppressants like Prochlorperazine, which we will be discussing in a later lecture. So this much for vertigo today as an introduction. In the next lecture, we will discuss the differential diagnosis and treatment of vertigo. Any of you who have not subscribed to my channel, please do so and also press the bell icon button so that you get a notification whenever I upload a new video. Thank you.